Hey, everybody. Welcome to Roger and Me, a twice weekly, sometimes now kind of mostly weekly because of our schedules, mostly my travel schedule. It's a podcast where we celebrate the late, great Roger Ebert, keeping his unique spirit of film criticism alive through rewatches of his seminal television program, Siskel and Ebert, and all of its iterations. And every Friday, which we're really sticking to, we're doing it. Every Friday, we're here reviewing all the new releases out in theaters. And this week, Mark Dujsik returns, and I am here as well. Where else would I be? I'm here. We're here to talk about 5 new movies. And yes, I know you're wondering already. Yes, Justin Long is in 3 out of 5 of these movies. That is correct. You were right to ask.
It was my first question.
Someone submits that question every week, and this time, it's come true. Justin Long is in 3 of these movies. This episode is called Roger and Me Goes Long, but it's going to be a regular length episode. It is not going to be lengthy, but we are going to go long. We're going to talk all about Barbarian, House of Darkness, and Clerks 3. Those are 3 films that include Justin Long. And then Medieval and Speak No Evil. I think this is quite a fun slate of movies to talk about. I am like chomping at the bit to talk about every single one of them. It's been a while since I've seen a couple of them. One of them's real fresh in my memory. I saw it last night in a nearly empty theater in Reno, Nevada, where I was all week. I got my phone stolen at the airport, and I've been without my phone and Twitter and email, and I lost access to everything that had 2-factor authentication, which is everything except for Letterboxd. So I was able to keep reviewing things on Letterboxd.
So you had the important thing.
Had the important thing.
Yeah.
I was watching Star Wars movies on my iPad while on vacation, and I was able to log them. It's very important. But I'm glad I was able to get screeners of all this stuff so we could be here on this Friday, a little late release. If you're one of the people who wakes up every Friday and wants to hear us, sorry that didn't happen today. You're going to have to, we can wake up tomorrow, listen to it tomorrow, or you can listen to it late on Friday night. Here we are talking about 5 new releases. Let's start with one that I believe is in theaters. And is it also on Shudder today?
Shudder next week.
Shudder next week in theaters today. This is a movie I saw at Sundance and I loved so much. I like tracked down the company and demanded they send me a screener for review purposes ahead of this week because I love this movie and I wanted to give it a fair shake when we talk about it. This is Speak No Evil, a Shudder original. And by that means they bought it out of Sundance. It's also an IFC film. Here you go. Don't copyright take down me, IFC.
I want a toast to Italy, of course, to the food, of course, and to love.
Salute. Dear Louise, Björn, and Agnes, how are you? We were just talking the other day how nice it was spending time with you this summer. We would love to invite you to come to visit us.
Yeah, you made it!
Sorry for the mess. Gonna get much worse. Come on.
Whoa, yeah. He's been cooking all day. He's making wild boar.
This is for you.
I'm a vegetarian.
I insist. I insist.
What's her name? Let's go.
Hi, Abel.
Abel has some difficulty speaking.
He has what you call congenital aglossia, meaning basically he's born without a tongue.
I just want to keep watching that trailer.
I know.
Because it's so intense and you don't really get a sense of what's happening yet from that trailer, but that's a good thing because I don't think, you don't want a trailer to ruin anything. Speak No Evil. First thing I noticed is that trailer appears to have a dub, an English dub, which is not how I experienced the movie. Is that how you experienced the movie?
It is not.
Okay,
I mean, they speak English a good amount of the time, but when they're talking together, but there are definitely lines of dialogue that are, intended to be in Danish or Dutch, depending on the context.
Right. Yeah. So, Mark, I'm going to ask the only question that can be asked at this point, which is, what is Speak No Evil? What is it about? Tell me all about it.
Speak No Evil is about two families who meet up by chance on a vacation in Italy at this nice little estate resort looking place. They kind of hit it off. One is from Denmark. The other one is from Holland. They both have they're both married couples, man and woman. Each of them has kids. One has a young, like preteen girl. The other one has a young boy. Then they kind of get along really well. Vacation ends, and the Dutch family invites the Danish family to visit for a week or a weekend. I think it's a weekend at their house. And you know, after some convincing, the husband, he's played by Morten Burian, convinces his wife, who's played by Sissel Siem Koch. I'm not sure how it's pronounced.
Yeah, I'm not going to pronounce any of these correctly either.
Yeah. Convinces her to go. And yeah, that's about where I think any kind of specific plotting should end. Any description of the plotting should end here.
Yeah.
And then I mean, in terms of the tone, right off the bat, you get a sense that it's a horror movie because there are these horns blaring on the soundtrack of this really just ordinary scene of a car driving down this road at night, and you're like, what is going on here? Where is this going? It turns out it's really not much of anything, but those horns, you know, stick with you and they tell you something bad's about to happen.
Yeah.
Which I think is really important, because if you just watch the film, you have no clue, because it starts off just this like happy little vacation movie about this family gets together, and it becomes sort of a comedy of manners almost about these two different families with different values, but they don't know that until they spend a bunch of time together. So there's this really just discomfort, but it's not in terms of thinking something bad is going to happen, except for the way that the soundtrack and some of the framing is the shots works out. But just that it's like, I don't like the situation because one family is very seemingly unaware of any kind of social mores, and the other family just sort of lets them walk all over them because they just want to be nice and polite. And it's really uncomfortable and kind of funny. And also,
very funny at times, but like in a way that you're like, you're cringing at the same time. Like it's so tense.
Yeah. So it's kind of, it's hard. I mean, it's, you have to stay upfront. And I think the film is very honest and upfront about it. It is a horror film.
It's a horror movie, and it's like a feel bad, slow burn.
Yeah. It's really effective, really, really effective as this study of what, you know, what we expect and how we behave around each other, even if we don't really know another person. And just this sort of feeling of just needing to keep things on an even keel, I guess, no matter how bad you feel, no matter how uncomfortable you feel, no matter how terrible some of the behavior that the people you're with seems to be doing. Because, you know, it's like the Dutch family makes the case like, you know, you can't tell me how to, you know, treat my child. But, you know, in certain circumstances, especially some of the ones that are here, maybe you should.
Yeah, it's like it's objectively wrong what you're doing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
It's really discomforting in a way that is both funny at times and completely anxiety inducing.
Yeah. It gets at like this human compulsion or something to like avoid confrontation, like to avoid looking at like what is so obviously in front of your fucking eyes, right? Like this movie really, that's what's so funny about it. The darkly funny is like, you're clearly watching a horror movie, and like that is part of the joy of watching it. If you can get a perverse joy out of watching it, is knowing you're watching a horror movie, and that like the things that you think are going to happen, like yes, bad things are going to happen. In fact, you probably don't even know how bad things are going to get. You couldn't even imagine how fucked up this movie is going to get. It is such a nasty, sneaky, it's like sneakily very nasty, because it is very funny while it's making all these incisive, like, if you want to call it social commentary, or I think you called it a comedy of manners, or however you phrased it, was very good. Because it is all those things, but at the same time, it does end up becoming like this third act, dark, brutal, I don't even know if it's a twist really, but it just comes to a head. Like it's building to this conclusion. Right. And it gets there and it delivers, I think, is what we're both saying. Right.
Yeah. There's a movie I'm desperate to compare it to, and I cannot, though. It's a Dutch film, and it's got the same sense of, you know, something bad is going to happen, but you have no idea the specifics of how bad it's going to be. But by the time it arrives, it feels inevitable. And it's about, I can't describe what it is without, I think, giving too much away, but it's a fairly well-known Dutch film from the 80s about a disappearance.
Oh,
it's
sure.
A synonym for a disappearance, but it's that same feeling of just, you have when the moment arrives and the whole sequence arrives, it really feels inevitable, because you just know, like, there was no other way this was going to play out based on the way that the characters are and based on what they do, and especially what they don't do.
And it has that like nihilistic, there's a line that's like famous from the movie The Strangers, if you're a horror fan. It's like, you know, why do you do this? And it was like, because you were home, I think is the line. And in this movie, there's like a, why are you doing this? And it's a, because you let me. And it hits really hard. It sounds kind of silly, and like, it is funny, but it's funny in the darkest possible way. And like, you will, the key test for me of a movie like this, which has like a, you could say this movie has like a fairly shocking late reveal, is if it's still enjoyable on repeat viewings once you already know like what the twist is or what's going on. Like, first of all, I would say it's not really a twist, but like, when you find out like the significance of like why it's called Speak No Evil, like I was like, oh, that's why it's called that. And like, it's twisted and clever. But the key test of this type of movie is, if you already know it, is it going to work when you see it again? And I'm thrilled to say that when I watched this again, it only enhanced the experience. I was squirming just as much, if not more, this time around, especially because, you know, so many early lines foreshadow what's to come in like cheeky and clever ways. I just think it's a damn near perfect horror movie. It gets at the true terror of social situations and the true danger and risk associated with being impolite, as you mentioned. It's as hilarious in that satirical way as it is actually disturbing, which is such a tough balance to nail, and I think the movie really does nail it. And you know, you put it, if I had to describe it in a sentence, it's, yeah, you know, imagine if your weekend getaway with a couple of quote-unquote new friends, which basically just means strangers, went from very uncomfortable to deadly, and it's just dripping with dread the entire time before it delivers on that premise that we've been watching in a way that's just so shocking and brutal and nihilistic, and you won't see it coming. I don't think you will, even though I'm telling you something bad's going to happen. There's no way. There's no way you would guess what it is.
Yeah,
it's just even like, if you, oh, shit.
Yeah, even if you know, it is, and by the end, it's just, it just hurts. It is so disturbing and upsetting.
It's relentless.
And horrifying.
It's absolutely relentless.
And I mean, yeah, and the fact that they're able to pull that off while also telling this really commonplace, down-to-earth story that's kind of funny and kind of, you know, makes a point about just how we interact as people in general. The fact that it can end on such a gut punch of just awfulness. I don't know how they pulled it off. The director is Christian Taftrup.
Yeah,
he's apparently like a well-known actor, and you can tell that because there are some really, really good performances here, and the camera really sticks with those actors and those characters in a way that really helps. There's really no way to describe the performances, I think, without giving too much away. But I mean, they're really, really great performances. A lot of subtlety to them, a lot of nuance. A couple of them are so static the entire time that it just makes everything by the end so much more terrifying, because you know the entire time, like, these people have been like this the whole time, and I've been watching them, and I don't know. It's just really, really good. I think it's one of the, you know, as of right now, it's definitely like one of my top five films of the year.
I'm right there with you. It's been in my top five since I saw it at Sundance, and it hasn't been knocked off yet. Very unsettling stuff. And it's really well shot and all that stuff too, of course. I'm so excited that people are going to see this movie, and I'm delighted that like it's playing at IFC Center right now in New York City. So you can go see it in the theater, which I haven't had the pleasure of doing. Maybe I'll do that this week. Anyway, this is a movie that you can go see in a theater. This is one of those movies where like the release strategy just completely baffles me. Like, how I had never heard of this movie until you told me we had to review it for this week coming out. And then lo and behold, I was in Reno, Nevada. And it's like that just to say, it was like a wide release. I was at the theater and there was a 7 p.m. showing of Medieval. Was there a single ticket sold? No, but it's there. And I liked it. I'm going to get ahead of it and say I liked it. So here's a trailer for Medieval, a movie starring Ben Foster, who I've always loved as an actor. And Michael Caine and a bunch of other recognizable actors. We'll talk more about it. Here you go. Medieval.
Power. Tyranny. Violence. Europe was engulfed in war, plague, and famine.
Jack?
I need your help.
Catherine.
It's the last chance to help this kingdom. Her uncle is the King of France. You must unite Europe. Kidnapping her is the only way. We don't kidnap women. The king's rules are God's rules.
Oh my God.
You're not letting me go.
I need you alive.
Yeah, we'll be close. I need to find her.
I know who did it. And those soldiers are never gonna find them.
Why?
Because I trained them. Tomorrow, she will be yours.
You must protect her.
All right, that's enough of that. This movie has so much plotting and stuff, I feel like. The trailer does get into a lot of it. So, Mark, I'll just stop in your tracks and ask you, what is Medieval?
Medieval is based on the true story of a Czech national hero from the medieval era. Someone that I think, story and a myth and a legend and all of that, that I think people outside of the region aren't really going to know. I certainly didn't. And this movie definitely didn't help me understand this man as a person or his historical importance to the area and to the country and to the empire, to this entire weird debate, this battle between two rival popes that's going on in the background that doesn't.
Yeah.
It's a very, very, very convoluted plot that doesn't really stop.
It requires
to explain anything.
It requires a Wikipedia summary to understand like the significance of what you're watching. Like you're right. I had no idea that I was watching like, where is this film set? Peter Jacker, where is he from? Peter Jackal.
It's set in, I mean, modern day Czech Republic, but it would have been, oh no, I forgot. It's been too long. Yeah. One of the empires at the time.
Yeah. This guy, the guy that this movie is based on is allegedly some iconic historic figure to the Czech people, right? So like that is like some baked in knowledge going in that we did that you and I just didn't have, and like mainstream audiences, at least in this country, will not have. So you're right, like the movie is just like this insignificant made up thing that happened to this guy, or this guy did before he became this legendary war hero, right? So it's like supposed to be like this origin story, or like a just kind of like a, yeah, like a pre his exploits that we know, here's what he was doing and here's how he got to be this iconic soldier. He's kind of like the comparable to like a King Leonidas in 300 figure, right? Where like the history, if you read the Wikipedia page about this guy, it tells about how he took on a huge army with only however many guys, and they, you know, I'm sure they died, but like they fought very hard or whatever, or they probably defeated them. It's some incredible story that like has become that like is knowledge to people of the Czech Republic. And this is the most expensive Czech film ever. There's so many interesting things about it. Like it seems like it was shot in 2018 and has sat on a shelf since then, or I don't know if it sat on a shelf or just had like an extremely lengthy and expensive post-production, and that's why it's the most expensive Czech film ever. But it just has, it's just a weird movie with a weird production I don't really understand. And Medieval is a terrible title, but you have to factor in, Mark, that The Two Popes was already taken.
Yes, so this is true.
I'm more forgiving of that title. But anyway, this movie, I'll have you can explain what it's actually about. I know it's convoluted, and I don't even know if you would be able to.
I mean, there's a basic plot to it.
Yeah, what's the basic plot to it?
So Ben Foster plays this man, Jan, I'm going to butcher this name, Zichka or something. It's two Z's with the accent marks.
Yeah, well,
it.
They all speak fine English in this movie.
They do speak very, very fine English, sometimes with English accents. It's very interesting. But I mean, that's to be expected. But I mean, it's got an international cast. You got Ben Foster. Michael Caine plays a guy that he knows who kind of figures into this whole thing. What I find interesting about it is, so the plot basically has Ben Foster's character being hired to kidnap the princess of France, who is currently engaged to one of the three people who are in line to become the emperor king, however, of the kingdom of Bohemia, which is one of many kingdoms that are in Europe at the time. And across the world at the time, but specifically in Europe at the time, there's a Pope in Rome. There's a Pope in France in Avignon at the time.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, an interesting historical fact. There's also all of this stuff with the Battle for the Throne. That's
Battle for the Throne with
too.
Matthew Good.
Matthew Good plays one of the guys too, who's battling for the throne. Till Schweiger from Inglourious Basterds is another one. It's a solid cast playing characters that are just there to have all of this plotting that I didn't understand. And I don't think the film really bothers to try to explain, because I think part of it is, I don't know if it's made specifically for a Czech audience who already knows this history, or if it's just kind of trying to give this general idea of, I mean, the movie starts off with Michael Caine just saying a bunch of words like violence and tyranny and intrigues. And it's like, the movie does give you all of that. It just doesn't give you any context to understand why any of that is happening and why it's important for, on a historical level, on a personal level for these characters. It's just there, I think, to have all of this stuff happen. And one's involvement in it, I guess, depends on how much you like these actors and how much you like really bloody, gory violence, because there's a lot of it.
Yeah, exactly. And that's where I'll step in and say that those elements go a long way. The bloody, violent action that is like really nasty, like horror movie level, visceral, like hands getting maimed, disgusting violence. And, you know, I'm a horror guy. That worked for me. Like, the battle scenes and fights are just, the only way I can describe them is medieval in the best way, in that don't you feel that you really feel the impact of like every blow on screen? Like, I really did feel that way. And it's brutal in exactly the way this type of movie should be, in that like it's the unflinching depiction of the horrors of violence of this type of stuff. And I thought it worked, honestly, even though I can't argue with you. Like, it's very convoluted setup for like, it doesn't pay off in the traditional way, because we don't know that this guy goes up, you know, as just guys who are watching a movie, we don't know that this guy goes on to be an iconic hero, other than because the movie at the end and like with a few words tells us. So like, there's no climb, like it doesn't hit. I don't know what I'm trying to say. It doesn't have a hugely satisfying ending or anything like that, or like even anything super memorable. Cause like, I saw this 2 weeks ago and I don't remember it super well, but I remember enjoying watching it. And like, it's a longish movie and I never was like checking my watch or like making sure that like, I really have to finish this? Like, I was totally with it. And I thought the brutal action worked, and I was totally engaged in the palace intrigue. That are like, clearly this movie's trying to do like Game of Thronesy shit with all the relationships.
It even references my favorite line, just because, you know, I think they filmed a lot of Game of Thrones in the Czech Republic.
Yeah,
I think they did. But there's a line, they actually say, winter is coming, in a few weeks. I was cracking up that.
They look at the camera, just stare directly into the camera.
In a few weeks.
Unbelievable.
It's clearly just trying to do, I don't know. It's just, it feels like it's just trying to do generic medieval action.
It didn't work for me. Braveheart, it's Northman. Just trying to do that, but it's not as epic as those two examples.
The violence starts to become a little over the top to a point where it starts to be funny. Like they introduce a lion.
Oh yeah,
to maul a couple of people.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I liked it in RRR when the animals got let loose, and I liked it in this movie when the lion got let loose. And you know, they spent a lot of money on that CGI lion, Mark. Give them some credit. I'm just kidding. I would never praise CGI animals in movies, but I did think that, you know, if you're gonna have I'll allow a CGI lion if it's going to attack some people in a fun way in your horror, in your medieval, whatever the hell this movie is, war epic that's going to gross like under $1 million this weekend. Like, how did, like, it's, I know, I guess it's a Czech movie and I'm sure it's doing fine over there.
Yeah.
But it's not going to make an imprint here at all. Yeah, I'm surprised it's not going straight to VOD. Yeah. I'm big in Czech bumper sticker for this one. Let's talk about what I think is the highlight of the week and maybe of the summer. Let's talk about Barbarian, a Searchlight picture that I do not understand how it is a Searchlight picture. I don't think it predates Disney era. So it seems like Disney made this movie, which is hilarious, objectively. Let's talk about Barbarian. And I haven't seen this trailer yet because I, you know, very fastidiously avoid watching trailers.
I haven't either, so I'm curious about this.
Yeah, and like as soon as the movie ended, I was like, I know exactly what the trailer would be, and I think it's going to be that. And that's good to me because I don't think it's going to give away anything, is my point. Here we go. Barbarian.
Oh, you've got to be kidding me.
Yeah.
This is 476 Barbary, right?
Yeah, I'm renting this place.
No, I booked it a month ago.
Are you sure you have the right place?
Yeah. What am I supposed to do?
Why don't you come inside and we'll call these idiots. Why don't you just crash here?
Oh, no.
I don't know if you got a great look at this neighborhood, but I don't think you should be out there by yourself. It's dry and there's a lock on the door.
By the way, I'm Keith.
Tess.
You take the bedroom, and I'll sleep out here on the couch. Sunshine.
God.
That's enough.
That's enough. It didn't give away too much at all. It's exactly what I thought the trailer would be based on the structure of the movie and how I thought they would have to sell it. But man, this is going to be a tough one to talk about, man. I'm eager to talk about it, obviously, for so many reasons. But it's one of those movies that you really don't want to say anything about. Other than you should go see this movie without knowing a damn thing about it. That trailer itself is a good enough setup, and I think that's all you need to know. But Mark, without spoiling where it goes, what is Barbarian?
Yeah. So these reviews are always fun to and terrifying to write about around. Because it's like, how much can you reveal? And that was kind of the position I was in writing about it, and now trying to talk about it. So let's just say Georgina Campbell plays a woman who rents a house online, shows up and discovers that somebody else has already rented it. Played by Bill Skarsgård, one of the many Skarsgårds. He invites her to stay in, and that's about where I want to end it, I think. I mean, because it starts off seeming to be a thriller about, can we trust this one dude? And it plays that way, and it plays really well that way. And the smart thing that Zach Cregger, he wrote and directed it, I think this is what, his second
theatrical movie? Yes. So a lot of people are calling it his debut, and I'm fine to call it his debut, because his other movie that he directed was a co-director job with Trevor Moore, who is now deceased, actually. The Whitest Kids U Know co-star. They wrote and directed Miss March together, which I'm sure you reviewed back on your site in 2009.
I did not, actually.
Oh, no?
No, I missed that one.
It is not good. And okay. I'm sure Cregger would like for this to be called his first movie, is my point. So I will indulge him and everybody else who's saying it's his debut film, because technically it is. This is his first solo writer-director debut. And I was... The most obvious thing I thought the second this movie ended, or not even before it ended, was like, oh, wow, we've got a new Jordan Peele. Like, this is a comedian who is doing a horror movie. And I saw in interviews, he's saying the exact same thing that Peele says, which is like, you know, the comedic sensibility and the horror sensibility are the same. Like, it's all about building the tension, and like building a joke is the same as building a scare and stuff like that. And I was delighted to find out that Cregger actually consulted with Peele on this movie, and Peele saw an early cut and helped him along the way making this movie. But the most amazing thing, again, I'm dancing around talking about the plot of it because I don't need to, and I can talk about why you should see it without knowing anything. This movie is so unpredictable in such a fun way that you'll be fully hooked even as you're like kind of confused by what you're seeing. It's so engaging on a scene by scene level. I think that has something to do with. Were you struck as much as I was by like how distinct a visual stylist Cregger is? Like, he has like, I don't know. I mean, obviously we'll have to see what his second film looks like, but he came out of the gate with such a distinct visual look for this movie. And like the camera work and like the way the camera follows people and is like attached to like a car door closing or something. And like the claustrophobia of the way it's shot. And like, I just thought it was like I was stunned by how basically the craft on display. I was stunned at this quote unquote debut filmmaker's level of craft in this movie. And he uses that craft to such great effect. He has so much fun with the camera. All it wants to do is fuck with the audience, I feel like. This movie just wants to like pull the rug out from under you. The movie wants you to think you know where it's going. The movie is just constantly one step ahead of the audience, I think, in a way that's really unexpected and fun. And I think this movie it's a shame that it's still early on Friday. I hope it's a hit this weekend, but it feels like it's going to not do super well. But it's a movie that really begs to be seen with the crowd, because like it's so tense at times and so scary. The guy behind me, this full grown adult 60-year-old man, shrieked more than once during this movie. It is genuinely tense and scary. And like the way he shoots a woman walking into a basement cellar, and like the way the camera lingers, he's got it down, man. He's a master craftsman. He got me. I was hooked. I was hook, line, and sinker the whole movie. And then it definitely takes like a, I would say, objectively Jordan Peelean twist, where it becomes like, this movie is about more than just this horror scenario. We're trying to say something. But it also is doing that without being overbearing. It's still just a fun, silly movie that works as like a trashy, like monster movie or whatever you want to call it, but it also works on this like other level that don't know how much you want to talk about that.
Yeah, it's hard to talk about. And I was a little worried when we're introduced to we've already established the actor Justin Long. This is the first of the Long three-peat in today's episode. I was a little concerned because there is a really strong sense of style and in terms of not just the imagery, but also juxtaposing imagery and certain ideas. So you have that opening shot of her on the porch, and the porch is the only place in this neighborhood that's lit. And the camera just moves around and it looks at this neighborhood, and it's really frightening only because you can see shadows and silhouettes of buildings and you have no idea what it looks like. But the next day you see that neighborhood in broad daylight and suddenly it's even more frightening.
That shot is like going to be stuck in my craw for a while. Like it was stunning. Like the colors, I can't even describe why it looks so good, but it just is like such a stark visual that gets at what this, you know, that gets at the social commentary, but under the
Yeah, but I mean, just the juxtaposition of those two images at different times, and the fact that you can make this nighttime scene of a neighborhood where you have no idea what's going on almost as scary however you do it. It's just different levels of scary. Kind of like there's a repeated motif of just darkness behind doors, which is, you know, a closed door might be the scariest thing, I think, the scariest image in a movie that it could possibly have, potentially. Yeah. And so when you have it open up and just the darkness and you have no clue, that's more frightening, potentially. But then I don't know how, but the stuff that you find when there's light behind those doors, it's even scarier. You can't talk about what's in these rooms, but it pays off that promise of like, there's something really terrifying that you don't want to see. And so here's some pitch blackness instead. It works really well. And so, yeah, I was a little concerned about a new character being introduced, but it's really neat how he's then able to play with doing the same thing, but doing it in a more comedic tone that's still unsettling because, you know, the Justin Long character is kind of for comic relief to a degree. That's all I'll say about him. But yeah, it works. It works as comedy and it works as horror when that shows up, and just to be able to balance all that stuff is really, really effective.
I think it's important to say, right, that like this is a movie that has the power to genuinely, like, it shocked me a few times. It's so assured in its pacing and tone that even as it goes back and forth, you just feel like you're in the palm of his hand. And I think it's important to mention how fucked up and crazy this movie is for a mainstream horror release. Like it is as trashy as something like, I don't know, Castle Freak or something, but it's a movie that is Searchlight Pictures, which technically means Disney made it. But the way that cinematography, I think, is the one element I have to compliment the most. It was like something about the way it was like inviting, but also scary. And it was just weird. It had like a weird, uncanny look to it. And I just am kind of stunned that this movie exists and is in theaters nationwide and isn't like a rare thing that you have to sneak and find on Shudder. But it's a real movie that exists. And I love that he definitely, as a filmmaker, is messing with his audience. And I feel like the whole operative thing here is like, yeah, I want to like set people up for what they're going to expect and then knock them down. They can't figure out what I'm going to pull off here. And I think it totally works. I definitely see a lot of people. There's some people there's something that happens in the middle that like maybe changes how they feel about it, and they wish it would have stuck with what the first half was and not done the second half. But I agree with you that it works. It just somehow works.
I was worried. But because he's a comedian, and I wonder if this is it. But you know, you can only do that trick once. You can only do that specific trick once. And I was a little concerned it was going to get a little too cutesy about moving back and forth in time. And it kind of does, but it also doesn't. And he knows, I think, potentially because of knowing some rules of comedy, you know, you can only pull off a surprise like that one time and get away with it. And he does only do it one time, technically, by introducing that one character. And then the next time we get something else, it's all exposition to set up something that, you know, is completely unexpected again and pays off in an unexpected way. I mean, it's completely unpredictable. Even I think if you knew a basic idea of what is going on inside this house, you wouldn't know how exactly it's going to pay off. And that's one of its strengths. But the biggest strength is, yeah, it's just really well made. Lots of, you know, smart,
really well craft. Made.
Yeah. Lots of great staging, lots of great camera setups, and just,
yeah. If you were to break it down, like, I could say 100 horror movies that this is just like. Like, there's certain elements that I'm like, there's like a whole storyline that feels like it's just Don't Breathe. There's a whole, I could name five Airbnb horror movies in the past 2 years, probably right now. There was the one called Superhost on Shudder, which was pretty, I thought was fun. There was The Rental, I think, that was directed by Dave Franco. That was also almost kind of good, but not as good as this at all. And then there was most recently that I don't think anybody saw. There was one called Gone in the Night with Winona Ryder that this is very similar
to. That was the one. I was trying to remember that setup. I felt so familiar.
I've been spending half of this time trying to figure out what that movie is called. I've been searching different search terms, and I finally figured it out. It was called Gone in the Night. You saw that, I presume.
I did, yeah. Yep.
It was pretty good, but like, it's funny that this and Barbarian have the same setup and they both kind of twist it in a way that you wouldn't expect either of them to do. And they both do it in different ways. So Airbnb horror, tried and true subgenre. I think Cregger did a great job of like fusing a ton of different, like potentially derivative horror ideas and making it his own. It feels like a Wes Craven movie or like a Stuart Gordon movie, man. Like, it is a fucking horror movie and it goes there. And I don't know. I can totally see it alienating some people with the twist or with like the whole Justin Long arc. Even I could see being a little
less people. That's like, gonna be interesting.
It's just like underlined the whole like, who's the real barbarian here? Like, it's very like, I could see it being like annoying, but in the same way that people were annoyed with Alex Garland's Men, you could call this movie Men. You know what I mean?
You could.
Like, it would work. It would be the same. It would work the same. And did
but
you know that
this
like
one you have not all men, because you know,
yeah, not all men. Here. Yeah, that's the thing. Or yeah. And like that element, which we're like spoiling without spoiling, is it was so refreshing, man. Cause like I went in not knowing anything about this movie. And I did think I was smarter than it. And I wasn't.
Nope.
I was like, I know what this is doing. It's so obvious. And it wasn't. And I have to give it credit for that. And I really love this movie, and I know we talked about it for probably longer than we should have here, but I will talk about it even longer on Monday on the New Flesh podcast. We'll go into all the horror-specific details. I really want to talk to Cregger, so I'm going to reach out to the people and try to get Cregger on the show. I think it would be a delight to talk to on the New Flesh. Barbarian, I realize we haven't done ratings.
We haven't. We can do that at the end.
We'll do a summary at the end. Barbarian gets two trademarked thumbs up from us, though. That's right.
And that's going to get us in trouble.
We're in big trouble. We're getting ceased and desisted. All right. So now Justin Long's character from Barbarian is going to hop over into this other movie called House of Darkness. And not only is this episode containing three Justin Long movies, but another fun fact is that this episode is a Neil LaBute movie. And it's not the second Neil LaBute movie in as many weeks, because I think Out of the Blue was 2 weeks ago, right? But it's two Neil LaBute movies in the span of a month, and that's impressive. The man had a impressive quarantine. I didn't get anything done. He got two movies done. So good for him. And thankfully, at least according to me, I'm not sure what Mark thinks of it, I thought House of Darkness was much better than Out of the Blue, which we both did not like. Here is House of Darkness trailer.
She's not very good at telling stories.
Oh, come on. I love stories.
All right. This guy meets this amazing girl. She doesn't have a ride.
I'm happy to.
They drive back to her place. This mansion in the woods.
We have several of these estates. Does that make sense?
You're rich.
And then they kiss. And he's never kissed before.
You could do anything you wanted to me. Make me disappear.
What do you mean?
You're not married, are you?
Not at the moment.
Not at the moment.
What's that?
Is somebody here?
Not that I know of. Let's play a game.
I don't want to play a game.
Let's play. Lucy, hello.
I thought this was just the two of us.
You still don't understand what's going on, do you?
Understand what? Oh my God.
I'm shocked to see the trailer go that angle, go that route.
Yeah.
They just straight up said Bram Stoker in the trailer. If you're not watching on YouTube, it said, what did it say? Did it say straight up an adaptation?
It said like a twist on Bram Stoker's classic tale. Like
a twist on Bram Stoker's classic tale, like which is to me, which is something I think we're just about to talk about, obviously, with House of Darkness, is that another fun fact connection between other episodes. This movie is strikingly similar to The Invitation, the Sony horror movie, PG-13 horror movie that was like dumped out a couple weeks ago. Or was that last week even?
I think it was last week. Yeah, it was like
it was last week. And like, so I think I have the spoiler. Can we spoil a movie from last week? Because like, I just want to say both movies have the same reveal that isn't a reveal. Like it is a reveal, but like if you're a viewer that's paying attention, you probably already knew it by the end of the first act, kind of. More so this one than The Invitation, I guess. The Invitation definitely like tries to have a third act twist, even though the trailer gives it away, like this one does. So there are so many comparisons. It's annoying to compare talk about other movies when I'm talking about House of Darkness, but it's so striking that in 2 weeks we saw two different modern takes on Dracula, essentially. And one of them is a Neil LaBute movie that is very much a Neil LaBute movie that is like about a man. Like, it's a movie about like, it's a comedy of manners. Does that work as a description?
It kind of does.
It's like except it's instead of a comedy of social manners and how you act around people, it's specifically about the relationship between men and women and like picking up women and like how men act in that scenario. And it's about like those roles. And like, it's so Neil LaBute to be making a horror movie about like trying to go home with a girl and like the well-intentioned guy turns out to not be so well-intentioned or whatever. What would you say this movie's getting at? I'm kind of getting ahead of it.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of the whole thing from the start, isn't it? It's, you know, Justin Long and Kate Bosworth are in a car and they show up at her mansion. And
her name is Mina, by the way,
is like, she has a sister.
The Invitation had that late reveal where like one of the first signifiers that you knew it was this Dracula story was a character's name was Harker or something. So it's funny that this also is like Mina Hark. It's like the same deal where like, we'll have a character name be a hint. And like, we're not going to outwardly say it's a Dracula movie, but apparently the fucking trailer did. But I didn't know that when I watched it.
Yeah. Oh, well, what are you going to do? I mean, it's not difficult to figure out. I mean, you know, you go to a mansion in the middle of the night and it's not like the movie and LaBute's not trying to hide that this is a horror movie. It's going to become something. The fact that is, I think that is to its detriment that it is a horror movie that has sort of just an obvious payoff, even without the elements of Mina and Lucy and everything else that's going on in here. But I was, and you're right, it is more enjoyable than Out of the Blue, which he did, which came out a few weeks ago, because it is about something. It's about the sexual dynamic between these two characters. It's about him trying to hook up with her without seeming too eager. And it's about her knowing that she has that power over him. And so playing like this mysterious woman who is very straightforward, that's exactly what he wants. And he makes a big point of saying, that's what I want out of a woman. It's so refreshing. He keeps saying that over and over again, how refreshing it is that this woman is, you know, trying to hit up on him. And she says, is that really true? It's all about lies and fibs and how we try to be honest and can't be honest about what we really want, and how eventually all of that falls apart. That's one of the fun things about it, is watching Justin Long's character just completely collapse. All of his trying to be the nice guy just go completely out the window, and he's eventually trying to start like a menage a trois. through the movie, like he's like this nice guy.
The whole movie's his awkward small talk, and he's really good. He's really good in this. Yeah, as this smarmy piece of shit, he's truly playing the same character he did in Barbarian, which we haven't. We won't get into that.
But. It's sort of a similar. I mean, without saying too much, it's sort of a similar arc of like a guy who thinks he's a good guy, or at least saying he's a good guy, and maybe not, but who knows? Anyway, that's all I'll say about that too. But yeah, it is enjoyable on that level. LaBute is really, really good at dialogue. Not so much in, Out of the Blue a couple of weeks ago, but in general, he's really good at dialogue. It's nice to see this kind of material, him going to this kind of material, because this is how he got his career started. He was a playwright writing about how awful men can be. And a lot of that got misinterpreted as, In the Company of Men is a great this film about
this. In the Company of Men, this is like the inversion of that almost.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah, that, it is.
Because what
In
the Company of Men is about two guys who, the whole plot of the movie is like they start a competition of trying to seduce the most vulnerable woman they can and like just ruin her just for fun.
Yeah, correct.
And what is this movie? Like,
this movie is exactly the inversion of that.
Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah. I mean,
so you, but I'm getting the sense that you didn't like this as much as I did.
I didn't. No, I didn't. I mean, and like I said, it's, I think, to the detriment of it being obviously a horror movie, and obviously being a specific type of horror movie, and very, very clearly moving towards an inevitable ending that, it's exactly what you think it's going to be. And the payoff didn't work for me. And by the end of it, it just feels like it's all about the payoff. And if that doesn't work, it didn't work for me. I mean, it just is,
Doesn't work because it's like, you can see it from a mile away. Is that why? Like,
because you can see it from a mile away. And because it really, once you kind of get the game that's really going on with the characters in the manor, it's, that's the punchline to it. And there's nothing else.
I mean, I'm definitely judging it on like a sliding scale of, this is a movie made on like no budget, shot in like one location. It's totally like a, chamber drama shot during COVID or whatever, post COVID. Like, I feel like I'm grading it on that scale, but on that scale, I really liked it. Like, I liked it quite a bit. I almost feel eager to watch it again. I just feel like it's one of those movies that is definitely not for a mainstream audience. Like, this is a movie that, it's a chamber play. Every character sucks and you don't like them. And the big reveal is barely a surprise. It's not like going to grab people, but I don't know. I think if you're a Neil LaBute fan, you'll definitely find plenty to enjoy here. And even if you're not, I think you'll might become a fan. Like, the dialogue is good and kind of biting and funny. But like, I guess it is. Would you say it lacks teeth?
I could say that.
I'm putting horrible shallot-esque puns in your mouth.
Yes, I could. I mean, you could say that. The performances are really good. Long, you're right. Long is really good playing smarmy jerk. I mean, he just is, and that's nothing about him. I enjoy seeing him on screen. Kate Bosworth is really good. Gia Crovetin, who is also in Out of the Blue in a very, very weird role, is really good here in this like deadpan performance of, someone who clearly can see through Long's character and doesn't try to hide it, unlike Bosworth's character. I mean, yeah, she's really good here.
He wrings a lot of humor out of like Justin Long really not knowing he's in this situation. Yeah. Like it's so obvious to the viewer, but takes him the whole damn movie to realize what's happening. I was shocked by how effective I thought this was as like a low budget horror movie that, we're going to make a Dracula movie with no budget and just people talking and it's going to work. I think it totally works. I had a really good time with it. So are you like flat I'm thumbs just, down on it, or
I mean, I'm mixed on it. If there's mixed. It's too bad. There's always that binary of
I know there doesn't have
down,
to be
positive and negative. It. There's I'm mixed yeah. on it. That's the best.
That's
way
okay.
To put it.
You're allowed to be mixed on it.
Yeah.
This is playing in New York City. I know right now as well, and I'm sure it'll be on VOD.
Yeah, I think it's soon. If it's not on VOD now, it will be soon enough.
Well, good for you, Neil LaBute. 1 out of 2 in the past month, we enjoyed. All right. The moment you've all been waiting for, surely.
An early review.
Another milestone of the show. We're doing an early review for a movie that is playing, I think, 2 nights only in a Fathom event.
Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So Tuesday through Sunday. Yeah, they expanded it.
Tuesday through Sunday, you can see Clerks 3 in a horribly presented format at your local theater because it's a Fathom event, and it will probably go through their pre-show projector and not their real projector. If things haven't changed since I was in the booth.
From what I understand, they have not.
They have not. Don't go to Fathom events. They're terrible. But
Unless
you really want to see Clerks 3, which wait for this review first.
We'll find out.
We did it in the 90s, son.
I can't catch my breath, man.
Really? Should I try mouth stuff?
What is this, a Tinder date? Get off of me. Oh, shit.
Mr. Dante! I need an ambulance at the quick stop.
You saved my life, man. Wish I had a life worth saving.
What are you talking about?
Sit around and watch the same movies over and over.
I always thought you could have made a cool movie.
You're right. I'm living on borrowed time. No more watching movies.
I'm gonna make a movie!
In a world where Kevin Smith forgot that he made Zach and Miri Make a Porno, Kevin Smith presents Clerks 3. Clearly a very personal movie. I think it bears mentioning that Kevin Smith suffered a heart attack at some point in the past few years and lost a bunch of weight and has changed his outlook on life, etc. And that definitely factors into the existence of Clerks 3, a movie that I don't know if anyone was particularly clamoring for outside of the View Askew rabid fan base that follows Kevin on tour, where he will be, in addition to the Fathom event, you could also pay more money and see it in a theater with Kevin, where you can all clap like seals at the references that he makes for you.
Or walruses.
Or walruses. Clap? They do. They love
Maybe
clapping.
We'll find out in Tusk 2.
Which apparently is underway. Kevin is threatening Tusk 2. He's like Quentin Tarantino in that they constantly are talking about projects that they'll never do. Whatever happened to Kevin Smith Hit Somebody? The hockey biopic that he was doing. There's so many Kevin Smith projects. Krampus, Comes the Krampus. There's like 100 Kevin Smith projects that I could name that never happened. But Clerks 3 did happen because Clerks has the name recognition. It was a huge hit, indie hit, back in 94.
Yep.
And then Clerks 2 had to be 2005, six. Yep. 2006. Saw it with my dad.
I did my math.
Saw it with my dad in theaters, who surely hated it, probably rightfully so. But I still have a soft spot for both Clerks movies. And then, I don't know, what's your relationship with Kevin Smith? Have you been following him? I mean, obviously you review movies, you've been following him, but like, have you watched the last few, like, not really real movie Kevin Smith movies? Like Jane Silent Bob Reboot. And
I saw that.
And what was before that?
Yoga Hosers. I saw that.
Okay. So you're
yeah, I've been trying to keep up. Red
so
State.
Red State. So you'll understand me when I say this, that no director in the history of film has regressed as a filmmaker more than Kevin Smith. Like, and I think he would agree with you. He jokes on his podcast about shit like that, about how he can't shoot movies. He's not a talented director, but he made a decision to like to pursue radio and like selling out shows and doing what he does. And I respect it and I love it. And I used to go see that type of thing. I was a huge fan, but he notably, his movies don't look like movies. They don't even resemble cinematic features anymore. Say what you will about Mallrats or even Clerks 2. Those movies were shot on film, I think. At least Mallrats definitely was. I think Clerks 2 probably was. But like, I just say that to say those movies at least have a cinematic quality to them by the virtue of the fact that they were shot for and made for theatrical and like by studios and stuff. And like, he's just not operating on that level anymore. And it, so when some other directors go low budget, it doesn't show. When Kevin Smith is making movies via basically like Kickstarters or whatever he was doing, or however he does things now, it shows. And it's so amateurish. And this movie has that amateurish quality that the last several Kevin Smith movies has. It doesn't have the, I don't think his early movies had any sort of visual panache or anything, but they were, I don't know, man. There's something to that.
It was always the writing. It was always the writing, yeah, and the characters that defined, you know.
Well, he's regressed as a writer too, then.
And he has, yeah. That's the problem, I think, when he comes down to it, especially with, you know, Clerks 3 right here. I mean, you watch Clerks and, you know, in 94, that's revolutionary. I mean, it was, you know, one of the first like big indie hits. You know, I was, you know, a teenager when that came out, and it was, you know, it was so weird. I was talking about it with another critic, like, you know, who's younger than me, and like, you know, to be alive at that time when all of these indie movies like that are just coming out of nowhere and you get to go see them because Hollywood is realizing they can make some money off of these smaller movies by putting them, yes, in theaters. And you can go to, you know, your local multiplex and see Clerks, or you could, yep, go and see Pulp Fiction, which was huge in the same year.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, it was a big deal, and I still love Clerks. I think too. Clerks 2 is really good too.
I agree.
That was like on my top 10 list that year. That's really so funny.
I feel like that's a controversial opinion to think Clerks 2 is good, but I'm with you.
Probably. I think it's really good. Because I think it gets at this idea of these characters.
The emotional, like, gut punch ending of Clerks 2, or like there's like a speech in a jail or whatever. Like, that shit actually got me because we like these characters, right?
Yeah.
And like, I wanted that from Clerks 3, and it tries really hard to do those emotional moments.
So
hard.
And
it strains, and it never hits at all, and it's embarrassing.
It doesn't work, because it is trying way too hard to get these characters. Oh, man, just from the beginning, it is trying so hard to get these characters exactly where they were at the very beginning. And it feels awful to reveal something really important about a character from Clerks 2 and how that character is treated in Clerks 3.
Yeah.
And I don't want to say it, but this character is basically just tossed aside. The existence of this character is completely nullified.
Well, not
just to get Dante to be the miserable guy that he was in the original Clerks, just so that Kevin Smith can go back and say, hey, remember I made Clerks back in the 90s? This is how I did it.
Yeah.
It's so frustrating, because there's so much potential just from this idea of these characters trying to grow up, but being stuck by their circumstances that they can't move past it and actually start up a life. What if Dante weren't the miserable guy he were at the beginning of the original Clerks and at Clerks 2? What, yeah, if he did have exactly what we thought he was going to have at the end of Clerks 2, and he has to deal with trying to be a person with obligations and responsibilities and still being in this position? And maybe that's why he's miserable, not because of this melodramatic turn that happens in the in-between movies so that we have no emotional connection to it.
I don't want to spoil it either, but I 100% agree with you. There's a scene with a character from Clerks 2 in some form, and it plays exactly like a comedy, like a joke scene from the movie MacGruber, where he like is having sex with his like Maya Rudolph dead ghost wife in a cemetery, and it's over the top and silly. There's a scene in this movie that goes for like an earnest emotional moment, but comes off like that fucking MacGruber scene. It is so completely outrageous what this movie thinks it can get away with on an emotional level. And the fucked up part is, maybe it's not fucked up, who am I to say? You know, the Kevin Smith fans who are in the tank are going to be fine with this and like be happy with it. But it's definitely one of those diehard only situations, which all of his movies have been for the past few years. It's definitely one of those. Like, would you believe me if I told you this movie relied extremely heavily on cameos? Like, oh, it's so lazy. It's all what you'd expect from Kevin Smith as of late. You know, far too lazy and first drafty and late period Kevin Smithy in terms of visuals to get behind, and relies heavily on cameos, engineered for a crowd of adoring fans to cheer at callbacks. There's one idea, there's one choice that I thought was so bold and compelling, and of course it's dropped as soon as it's introduced to make more time to repeat lines or flat out recreate scenes from Clerks or Clerks II. And the bigger problem, though, is what we keep talking about. It's like a huge choice was made. That's the crux of the emotional weight of the movie. And it all falls so fucking flat that the whole thing is just such an embarrassment to behold. I truly can't get past what they did to that character. And yeah. Talking about another character, like every character from Clerks 2 gets a shitty treatment, because I liked Elias in Clerks 2. I thought he was funny.
I did too. Yeah.
And he is insufferable here.
Yes.
Just insufferable. And like, it's not him, it's the writing. It sucks. Yeah. Kevin has made, no, Kevin doesn't like critics and like whatever. I still would love to have Kevin on this show to talk about his time hosting on At the Movies and stuff. But like, I'm not gonna sugarcoat anything and say I liked Clerks 3 so Kevin can do my podcast, maybe. I definitely think the movie sucks, man. And I find it sad that Kevin is making Clerks 3 and this is what it looks like. I feel like we all make fun of Adam Sandler, right? For like making movies with his friends, like taking Netflix money and going to Hawaii and making a movie with his friends. And that becomes the biggest movie on Netflix or whatever. Kevin Smith's doing the same thing, but like it's a much smaller scale, right? It's just him and his buddies, and his fan base are in on it because like he can't get normal. Well, this movie has the Lionsgate. It has a distributor, and it's, even though it's not getting a real release, it's getting that Fathom release. It'll make probably its money back for Lionsgate.
Yeah, and it might end up in a, you know, theatrical. It'll definitely get some.
It'll make its money back for Lionsgate for sure, because it costs nothing. But it's definitely, don't be fooled by the fact that like Kevin Smith's first movie on like an actual studio for in years. Like, no, it's still low rent, as if it's one of these things he did after he started his podcasting career. I don't know how steeped in Kevin Smith lore you are, but what happened to Kevin was cop out happened. Cop out definitely happened, but before cop out, right before, 2 years before, is when he made Zach and Miri. And Zach and Miri, oddly enough, is when Kevin Smith started smoking weed. You'd think Kevin Smith, Silent Bob, was a huge stoner. He was not. He never smoked at all. But Seth Rogen turned him on to weed. And I'm sure there's a contingent on some fucking Kevin Smith forum somewhere that is angry and talking about how Seth, you can like trace Kevin Smith's downfall to him becoming a huge stoner on Zach and Miri and deciding, you can hear him in interviews talking about, he does, you know, all he does is talk on his podcast. He talks about this a million times, all about how, you know, he doesn't care to make movies anymore. He knows he's not a good director and he just wants to like do what he wants to do and like not please studios or whatever, because those movies, like Cop Out wasn't a hit and Zach and Miri didn't probably make much money. But ever since then, like Cop Out was his last real movie. And that was the first time he directed something he hadn't written. And that's the only time, right? I don't think he ever did that again.
Yeah, I think that was the only director for hire job he had.
Only director for hire job. And it was a horrible experience. But you know what? I love that Kevin came out and apologized after for shit-talking Bruce Willis for all those years after Bruce Willis came out with his aphasia diagnosis. Kevin was very noble about that, because Kevin had spent a lot of time shit-talking how awful it was to work with Bruce Willis, etc. That's all nonsense. I just know a lot about Kevin Smith.
You just do.
I don't know why.
Which means that this is like, in theory, this is a movie,
I should be in the
directly
tank
at you.
Yes, it's
and
a movie.
It should be targeted at me, because I'm a big fan of Clerks and Clerks 2. And I did hope that, you know, Clerks 2 felt like a comeback for him at the time, because he had just done Jersey Girl and his career was going down. And suddenly he does Clerks 2 and it feels like he's, you know, got a revitalization of creativity. And so I was kind of hoping like, oh, Clerks 3, Let's see what you do with this. Let's get these characters that we like back and see what you do with it. And instead, it's just a nostalgia trip. And it's so unfortunate. It feels good at times, you know, seeing these characters again. And when the jokes
hit,
they hit. It
does for like the first 5 minutes. I was like, oh, this is cool. Like, this montage is making me nostalgic. Like, I'm totally in the tank. And then the movie starts and it's like, oh, this is just embarrassing rehash repetition, like nostalgia fest for diehards only. It's a bummer. And I'm I was once a diehard, and I think it's a shame that I really do think Kevin was once his movies were, he was a great writer. He was a good writer. And I do not think he has, I think that, you know, obviously that skill is there. And I just think he doesn't care. He said as much. He does not care to refine it. These movies all have like a first draft energy, and it could benefit from a second or a third, I think. So if we're ranking, let's do a quick rundown. Clerks 3. I can't believe it exists. Clerks 3. It's out. It's coming out. And I'm giving it 1 salsa shark out of 4.
I'm giving it a very, very generous 2. Oh, I'm trying to think of a good reference here, but I can't.
Yeah, I'm glad Salsa Shark.
Two fake lungs.
That's good. I'll take that.
Yeah.
So 2 out of 4 for you, 1 out of 4 for me. House of Darkness gets a 3 out of 4 for me, and I'm gonna guess
2.5.
2.5. Yeah. Okay, 2.5 for you.
Right in the middle there of just like, eh.
And then what else did we talk about? Barbarian gets a 3.5 out of 4 for me.
Nice. Gets a solid 3 out of 4 for me.
Okay. And the first movie we talked...
Well, we got Medieval.
Medieval. Medieval gets a 3, a generous 3 out of 4 for me.
2 out of 4 for me. Just, yeah. I mean, I wasn't involved in it.
Not involved. And what was the first movie we talked about?
Speak No Evil.
Ooh, Speak No Evil. I'm going to give the emphatic 4 out of 4. Like, I love this movie. I think it's great.
Nice. High 3.5 out of 4 for me.
That's strong. That's a strong, a mark 3.5 holds weight, I think. All right, Mark, thank you for making the time today to do this. Oh, yeah. I will edit it and get it out so everyone can watch this and listen to this before they go and make their movie plans for the week. What am I going to do today? I'm going to go see The Woman King after this, and then we'll talk about that. Is that next week?
That is next week, along with a bunch of other stuff that I don't even want to try to promise because there is so much.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that I'm going to try to see, and based on my schedule, I think I'll be able to do it. I told you in a DM, I'm going to look at it real quick. Here are all the movies for next week, maybe. We've got Moon Age Daydream, which is a David Bowie documentary that's opening exclusively in IMAX for a week before opening wider. Then we've got Pearl, which is the stealth prequel to Ty West's X that he shot at the same time, starring Mia Goth, that I'm very excited about. I think Mark's already seen. I missed a screening while on vacation, but I'm seeing it ahead of time on Tuesday, my birthday, by the way, for those keeping score at home. See How They Run, which looks like a fake Wes Anderson movie. I don't know how else to describe it. The Woman King with Viola Davis. And there's something called God's Country that I saw at Sundance that apparently is coming out. And something called Silent Twins. Can't guarantee that one. Blonde is coming out theatrically, I believe, next week. So hopefully we'll cover that. And Fletch. Confess Fletch is probably a streamer, but...
It's got a theatrical release.
Does it?
Paramount's.
I mean, Paramount's, it would be nice if theaters made a concerted effort to let us know that they're putting movies in theaters. Because I have no idea that these things are happening. Anyway, that's all next week on Roger parentheses Ebert close parentheses and me. That's a much better title, clearly. All right, bye.
The show starts in one.
Look there!
Hold.
I don't think I can go on.
Dragon's up. Shut up. Oosh.